Invite Naval District Washington Regional Fire Chief Kevin Grinder to the podium for remarks.
Good morning. Thank you for being here this morning as we remember and honor the life and ultimate sacrifice of Naval District Washington Firefighter Brice Trossbach. For those who do not know, I'm Kevin Grinder, Fire Chief of the Naval District of Washington Fire Department. On behalf of the officers and firefighters of the Naval District of Washington Fire Department, I would like to offer and extend our condolences to the family and friends of Firefighter Brice Trossbach, who was assigned to Naval Air Station, Patuxent River Station 2. At 4:41 on Tuesday morning, I received a call that no chief wants to receive, and I hope to never receive again. It was believed that our department had suffered its fourth line of duty death, and that it was Brice. It's important that we never forget their names, so I will say them. Firefighter Trossbach joins Herbie Wells from the United States Naval Academy, who died in 1963. Battalion Chief John McDonald, Joint Base Anacostia Bolin, 2014. And Firefighter Brian Hamilton, Naval Support Facility Indian Head, 2021. Additionally, let's not forget the men and women assigned to Pax River have also suffered through the losses of Captain Joe Bean and Fire Inspector Walter Taylor. Through it, we will continue to take care of each other while picking up and carrying on our life-saving mission. Last night, during the fireman's prayers, I spoke of Brice's love and commitment to his family and to his community. I call on each of you in the room to honor Brice by renewing your love and commitment to our jobs, our community volunteer organizations, our family, and our friends, and put your special focus on the needs of others, just as Brice would and just as Brice did. You always hear the term fire department family, brotherhood, thrown around during these tragic times. But what does that mean? This week, I found out what it meant when I walked into the Trossbach home during their darkest hour and was treated as one of their own by Warren and Diane. We live in the daily grind of news reports in a world gone mad. We work in a career where we see, serve, and save all to the best of our ability. The last 10 days, my faith in humanity has been renewed, even though my heart has been broken. I have observed hundreds of fire and EMS providers from around the DMV and around the country stop what they were doing, put their families and jobs aside to ensure that Brice's send-off today was fit for a hero. To those of you who put Brice's send-off as your top priority, I thank you. In Psalm 34, verse 18, we're told the Lord is close to the brokenhearted and saves those whose spirits are crushed. I pray that he remains close to the family, the NDW and St. Mary's County Fire and EMS personnel, and the community as we move through the days and months ahead. To Cheyenne, Warren, Diane, Jared, Caitlin, and Rhett, thank you. Thank you for sharing Brice with us and the entire St. Mary's County community. And more importantly, thank you for raising a son committed to his community and his friends and putting their needs above his. There's one more family that I'd like you to hold close, the McNeil family, who lost their home and their memories in a tragic fire. Richard McNeil, a retired Navy chief, and his family have been holding your family, our Navy family, and the volunteer firefighters in their hearts throughout these difficult days, despite their own loss. Brice would expect nothing else or nothing less for us to continue to take care of them as well. Firefighter Trossbach, you'll be missed by your NDW family, not your coworkers, your family. We stand ready to support you, family's needs, in the hours, weeks, and days ahead, in the years to come. Brother, we got it from here. Thank you.
Cliff Montgomery, Naval District Washington, District Fire Chief, Department of Health.
Good morning. On the 25th of June, which was just 2 days before the tragic events of that Tuesday morning, I attended a Mass at St. Joseph's Church, St. Joseph's Parish in Pomfret, Maryland. Normally, as usual, my mind would wander during the sermon, but for some reason that day I paid a little bit extra attention to the visiting pastor. He was from a very poor area in South Africa. He told a story of how his community and his towns were virtually untouched by the coronavirus, which is very odd. They had zero health care, they were very remote, and it would have been a devastating time for them had they experienced the effects, which was in stark contrast of the Western world, you know, the losses that we had. His message at that point was that God puts the heaviest burden on the strong and protects the weak. So fast forward to the events of Tuesday, and I wondered, why us? Why Brucey? Why Pax? Why, after the experiencing the loss of Captain Joe Bean, Inspector Taylor, and now Brucey in the last 4 years, why did this happen? So I went back to that thinking, okay, well, you know, I'm not a super religious guy. There's probably a scientific explanation. But that gave me some solace knowing that maybe God was putting the heaviest burden on us because we can handle it. During my career, I've often wondered, seen several line of duty deaths, and I wondered how these chiefs deal with this. It's a club I never asked to be a member of, but I do know I'll never be able to cancel my membership. The answer is this: we have to go on. We're firemen. That's what we do. We take care of each other, and we take care of those that we are in charge of. One thing that really helped me the first few days after Brucey's passing was spending time with the three guys that were his engine company that night. After we left the scene, we went to the fire station number 2 so his crew could do the things that we hope we never have to do in our career. His crew picked up his shoes that were left on the floor. They went to his bedroom, made his bed, folded his clothes, closed his locker door for the last time. There was no way that them guys were going to let anyone else do those most menial tasks that meant so much. There were several conversations during these rides from Baltimore and back. The vast majority of those conversations, extremely inappropriate, and has probably reserved all four of us a special place where the fires never go out. Those few hours were kind of like a debrief for ourselves. We didn't even know it was happening at the time, but we did. We discussed plans on how I was going to honor Brucey. And, of course, I had the bright idea that we would dedicate the new Webster Field Firehouse to him. Till one of the guys said, "Chief, he effing hated working there. Don't do that." So I think that was going to be off the table. What stood out to me and really kind of lifted the burden on all of us was hearing the stories that them three were telling during those 2 days of running back and forth between Baltimore. So the stories leading up to the 27th, when all four of them were anticipating what they were going to get into that shift, they're a younger crew. So any chief that has an engine company or a company full of younger guys, expect the unexpected. You see, firemen sometimes know when they're going to a fire. And that day, without a doubt, them guys knew that at some point during that day, they were going to a fire. All the stars aligned, Brucey had the crew that he knew shared his passion to be the best of the best. Drew Wallace, Goose, was his wagon driver. He had Daniel Busel and Brett Kareen in the back. Not taking anything from any other crew or of any other apparatus of any other fire station in the world, but those four were one of the crews that any command officer would look up from the command board and say, okay, these guys got it. Such is the case Tuesday morning with Chief Bell. He had no doubt that when he had nothing to worry about when Drew Wallace pulled that orange maxi brake on engine 132 and he looked up and saw Brucey, Kareem, and Busel coming across the front yard. That shift began with Acting Captain Trossbach filling out the daily roster, as the acting captain always does, and leaving the details of who was running line and who was laying out to Busel and Kareem. The breakfast decision was made. They were going to go to Wawa, get something to go, and head back to fire station number two. Cooped up by Post Malone was playing on engine 132 stereo during the trip back. Normal firehouse tales and stories were told during that meal. Busel, just being back for the first time since the birth of his daughter, Willow May, decided he would take the opportunity to rest his eyes a little bit while Brucey, Wallace, and Brent picked up his slack and got to work washing engine 132. Later in the day, as luck would have it, as soon as the crew arrived at the base theater to assist with the AED training, the engine had to take in a fire alarm on base, so they got out of heaven doing that work detail and didn't have to go back. With only a few shifts under his belt, the driver of engine 132, Firefighter Wallace, on that fire alarm, decided to take the most direct route to the scene, using roads that had not even been discovered yet on PACS, requiring another quick wash of the engine company. Busel again took this opportunity to get in a few minutes of rest. The dinner decision was made shortly thereafter. This shift's dinner was going to be pickle juice marinated chicken thighs, pan-seared green bean, and smashed cheesy potatoes. A meal that will forever have its own name, which is entirely inappropriate based on the short pickles that were used in the recipe. See one of them guys for the actual name. I was told this is live streaming, and I can't do that. After dinner, a normal firehouse dinner, the guys decided that they were going to go out and get dessert. They decided on Donut Connection ice cream. When they got there, both guys in the back of the engine assumed that ice cream was going to be a snack of choice among them all, until they looked over and noticed Brucey munching on a donut and drinking chocolate milk, most of which was laying in his mustache. The remainder of the evening was relatively quiet, except for a canceled fire alarm around 10 p.m. The crew retired to the bunks, which ended the best part of the worst shift of their lives. At 4:07, the crew was alerted to a structure fire of Deerwood Park in Leonardtown. Once the crew mounted up on the wagon and left base, they were heading towards Route 5. It was quickly realized that they were heading to the fire that they were waiting for. Approaching the scene, Firefighter Wallace looked over to Brucey and asked right or left. Being that there was only a left-hand turn on Deerwood Park Drive, Brucey quickly replied, "Where the F are you going to turn right? Into the trees?" Engine 132 arrived on the scene. Brucey turned around and said, "We got work, boys. Thank you."
Chief Bell from Leonardtown Fire Department, do you have remarks? John?
Good morning. For those of you who don't know me, I am John Trossbach, Deputy Fire Chief of the Leonardtown Volunteer Fire Department, and Battalion Chief of Naval District Washington Patuxent River. On paper, Bryce's fire service career began in October of 2014, but Bryce was part of our fire service family as soon as he was born. Bryce and Jerry both picked up their love of the fire service at a very young age in their father Warren's footsteps. As soon as they could walk, they were at the firehouse with their dad, checking out the apparatus and learning about the family business. Warren, a lifetime member of the Leonardtown Volunteer Fire Department, served as the engineer for many years and would spend countless hours at the station making repairs or just doing general maintenance to our units, which was completely fine with Bryce and Jared because that meant they could be at the firehouse all the time. Bryce and Jared were brothers through and through, and in the early years, Jared, being the big brother, would tell Bryce what to do in typical sibling fashion. But as they got older, Bryce would test Jared's theory from time to time and show Jared that although he was the little brother by age, he was the bigger brother in size through a couple of what we call spirited debates from time to time. Bryce was an asset to the Leonardtown Volunteer Fire Department long before he officially joined our department, spending countless hours at the station with his dad and brother, keeping our fleet in the best shape possible. Bryce was recognized by the chief in 2009 with a special award of appreciation for all the time and dedication he had given to our department without even being a full-fledged member. Just after his 16th birthday, Bryce was elected to official membership with our department. From that time forward, Bryce was always around the firehouse, riding calls, helping new members, and taking training classes to be the best he could, as well as achieve his next goal in becoming a career fireman. In 2019, that dream came true when he was hired by the Naval District of Washington Fire Department and assigned to Naval Air Station Patuxent River. Bryce was the kind of guy you always wanted around. He was passionate, level-headed, and would get any job done he was ever assigned, usually exceeding the expectations of the task that was given. Even though he left Leonardtown for a few years to join Bay District, he would still come to Leonardtown and hang out with the guys and catch a call from time to time, too. When he decided to come back to Leonardtown, he picked up right where he left off. Bryce would often assist with training personnel on Monday nights or give input on what drills we could do to hone in on specific skills. Bryce's personality had a way of drawing people close to him, and after you spent any time around him, it was obvious he was a fireman's fireman. He had a love for the job that any department would benefit from by having him as a member. Although we all have a huge hole in our heart right now, Bryce's memory will live on forever, and we are all better firemen having been able to work side by side with him. Rest easy, Bryce. We will take you from here, fireman.
At this time, I'd like to ask the commanding officer, Naval Air Station Patuxent River, if he'd like to make a few remarks.
I will say this, we're so sorry for your loss. I don't think words can bring back anything or make it feel any better. We're all feeling it, and I'll end on this. This is not about me, it's about him, it's about Bryce, and it's about coming together. I'm so proud to be on his team, and I'm so proud to see everyone from all the surrounding cities and from out of the state coming to honor him and the life that he did, so others may live. Thank you.
At this time, I'd like to invite representatives from the International Association of Firefighters for their remarks.
Cheyenne, Mom, Dad, Jared, family, distinguished guests, friends, all, thank you for joining with us here today. My name is Scotty Burkhardt, Jr. I'm the president of National Capital Firefighters, IAFF Local 121, chairman, Professional Firefighters of Maryland, IAFF Local A19. I'm joined by District Vice President James Johnson, State of Maryland President Jeffrey Bottle, Patuxent River Vice President Steve Stockwell, Secretary T.J. Hill. This morning, we mourn the loss of one of our own. On top of our brother's successes and selfless acts of duty, our brother served our department as shop steward for Naval Air Station Patuxent River. I became union president in 2020. At the time, Vice President Stockwell and I have been two of the longest-serving members of our executive board. We have forged a trusted relationship as peer firefighters, officers, and more importantly, dear friends. One of the first orders of business Steve and I had was the direction we were going to take our local and our department. Steve had a new guy who'd been there about a year ahead of me. A guy much like Steve who'd become a trusted confidant, a friend, Bryce Trossbach. Cheyenne, or anyone who knows Bryce will tell you, Bryce loves the work we do. He lives for the drama of it, but more importantly, having a positive impact on our careers. As a leader, he was a uniter, a refreshing take on how business can be done. Bryce is a driven firefighter. His values carried over in his leadership with the International. As with any bargaining unit firefighter, there are loopholes and documents which drive everything we do. Once upon a time, there was a career of ours that found one of those loopholes and consulted Bryce on the value of making an issue of it. Bryce very calmly, in a manner only he could convey, said, sure, go with that. While I might have a leg to stand on with this, you sure as hell won't be mine. Now, I can assure you there are a few more expletives in there, but the intent behind that statement just showed to us how wise, how principled, and brilliant of a union leader he truly was. Right there, he reiterated to all of us, just do the right thing, when no one's looking. To Cheyenne, thank you for sharing your best friend with us. Thank you for allowing him to rant and rave with us on the phone late into the nights over everything and nothing. Thank you for letting him pick up when he called at my convenience. We should have been spending more time with you. I will treasure every phone call, every conversation, and every beer I drank with Bryce Trossbach. I will treasure that every day moving forward. The International Association of Firefighters is indebted to Bryce Trossbach, not just for his service as an officer in our union, but for the bravery he demonstrated last week. Pursuant to IAFF 1990 Resolution number 85, we shall honor him here today. I describe this award as I would the Victoria Cross, a single suspended award inscribed with the name of the recipient, the date of his actions, hung on a ribbon of only a single color, simplistic, beautiful, and immediately recognizable to any Canadian or American in any form of public service. At the direction of President Ed Kelly, on behalf of General Secretary Frank Lehman, 16th District Vice President Johnson, 4th District Vice President Andy Pantelis, the IAFF Executive Board and staff, Professional Firefighters of Maryland, IAFF Local 121, and the entirety 330,000 professional firefighters of the United States and Canada, we proudly present the Martin E. Pierce IAFF Medal of Honor, number 4535, Bryce Clayton Trossbach, for service and sacrifice rendered on June 27th, 2023. This e-board will never forget everything we have learned from Bryce. We will carry on his legacy of maturity, kindness, and passion in everything we do. We will never forget the person that he was, and for just being the guy that would do anything for you. As we depart here today and return to what we do best, we challenge each and every one of you to be a little bit more like Bryce. As Bryce always says, it's time to shine. When you look to the sky and you see that new star shining a little brighter than the rest, that's our brother. He still has your back. He's still going to give you the path, and he's still going to give you the guidance to facilitate excellence in everything that we do. Cheyenne, Mom, Dad, Bryce, thank you.
Is there anyone else who would like to make remarks? Okay. At this time, we'll have the dismissal and the closing prayer. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you in prayer with you knowing that our hearts and minds are full of pain and sorrow following the tragic loss of our loved one and community hero, Brice. We pray now that he is counted among the saints in heaven, enjoying the reward prepared for him for all eternity. We know in our hearts that Brice's death was not in vain as he carried out his oath to save life and property as a firefighter. We who are left to mourn have the assurance of knowing that Brice made the supreme sacrifice for his fellow man. And upon his last breath on this earth, angels and martyrs led by St. Florian presented him to God Most High. These things we humbly pray in Jesus' holy name, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Sorry, guys. Brice wouldn't expect anything less for me to screw this up. And I don't know how I'm going to follow up those guys. So I'm going to give Brice's eulogy one more time. Good morning. Chief Croker of the FDNY once said, "I have no ambition in this world, but one, and that is to be a fireman." The position may, in the eyes of some, appear to be a lowly one. But those who know the work of which a fireman has to do believes that his is a noble calling. Our proudest moment is to save lives. Under the impulse of such thoughts, the nobility of the occupation, thrilling to deeds of daring, even supreme sacrifice. Brice Brucey Clayton Trossbach was the bravest of the brave. For those that don't know me, my name is Jared Trossbach, lieutenant with the Prince George County Fire and EMS Department, but more importantly, Bryce's big brother. And as John pointed out, not by size. Sorry if I don't look up. I can't look at Cheyenne. She's either going to make me laugh or make me cry, and I'm not doing either one of those while I'm up here. On October 4th, 1997, my mom and dad gave me the greatest gift ever. They gave me Brice. And he sure did love his mama. Little did I know, he'd become my best friend. Brice began his fire service career with my dad and I at Leonardtown, just like me since birth. As kids, we wanted to be the best, just like our dad. Brice was the best man at my wedding, and I want to remind you of the stories that he told of wrenches being thrown across the engine bay. But what he didn't tell you, or tell everyone, was the time that we were fixing the valve on engine 12, and Brice and I exchanged some words, and in the end, it ended with me suplexed on the floor, and Brice saying, "Square up, bitch. I'll curb stomp your ass." Whatever reason, that and the times our dad would spray us with the garden hose to cool us off, entertain all the guys at Leonardtown. Brice loved the fire department. To gain more knowledge and experience, he joined and lived at Bay District Volunteer Fire Department. And I would never tell him this, just because I was on most of the same fires, but he always caught more fires than me, even to this day. Naval District Washington, NAS Patuxent River, Leonardtown Volunteer Fire Department, Bay District Volunteer Fire Department, and the fire service as a whole lost a legend and the greatest fireman I will ever know. Brice, just like myself, wanted nothing more than our entire lives to get paid to do what we loved. I made two phone calls within 10 minutes of me getting off the phone with the fire chief when I got promoted. My wife, Caitlin, and then Brice. He said, "Good shit, I'm proud of you." and that meant the world to me. Sort of like the day he got hired with NDW. That's where he gained the name Brice. Brice was a dude who couldn't play a lick of basketball, but he was truly a fireman's fireman. I only knew of some of the stories, and over the last 10 days, I've learned so many more that all they do is just make me laugh. But I can assure you, he loved NDW, and he loved being a union rep. As Scotty said, he loved something about the drama, and I've been told he was good at it since day one. The fire service wasn't the only love of his life. Cheyenne came into his world. At that second, I knew she was the right one for him. If anyone knew them together, you'd probably envy them. They were perfect for each other. Cheyenne told me the other day that they never fought. Maybe it was because he was tired of fighting and beating up on me since we were little. But whatever the reason was, it was beautiful. Bryce also loved his not-so-little baby, Molly. Cheyenne and Bryce went on a road trip to Ohio to get the St. Bernard. Even though she ate socks, they loved her, and she thinks she's a lab dog. Whatever Bryce did, he did 110%. Whether it was the fire service, loving Cheyenne, mowing grass, saving money like Dave Ramsey, or drinking sour beers, it was always Brucey's time to shine. But it was only if he wanted to do something, because we all know he was only doing it if he wanted to. And we all know if it was time to leave, it was time to leave. Bryce had the best soul. He could always make anyone laugh and always was level-headed. When you saw the worst in a situation, he'd give you a positive. His baby blue eyes, that little giggle laugh, and as Cheyenne named it, his musty mustache, would always give you some sort of relief. I could go on with so many stories of the best human I ever met. I could tell you about the love he had for his nephew and how watching Rhett and Bryce together, which are the two best huggers I know, were always my favorite thing. And I can tell you about the time that Bryce came over and Rhett was hitting my Mustang with a wiffle ball bat. And just to calm me down, Bryce said, "Hey, buddy, we don't do that." He sure loved his family. From going to Virginia to see Cheyenne's mom and stepdad to cutting up cows at the farm with Crazy Pat. Cheyenne's brother Sean was just as much of his brother as I am. And growing up, Bryce was also like a big brother to our little cousins. I could also tell you about how Bryce and Cheyenne just got a boat. They loved being on the water. Except for the one time that him and Uncle Joe went crabbing in a small craft advisory, and as Bryce would describe it, the waves were crashing over the boat. Bryce had a wild side too, and just like basketball, the band had no rhythm to dance. He'd get his little head bob going, and if his little smirk had teeth showing, look out, he has arrived. If you saw Bryce's teeth, my tongue hanging out, and Cheyenne and Caitlin singing in cursive, we were having the time of our lives. We were the four best friends that ever lived. Now Caitlin is missing her other voice of reason with Bryce gone, because it was always trouble trying to get Cheyenne and I to leave. And if anything I can say from the last 10 days, Caitlin's had a lot of trouble with that. Sorry, Ricky. Cheyenne told me the other day that Bryce would be eating the shit up. And if that's not the truth, then I don't know what is. The last story I want to end with, and the last line of this speech, are from Bryce's best man speech. And Bryce ended with this speech at my wedding. In high school, we went to a house party. More specifically, Nicole Law's house, if she's out there. This was one of those nights where his teeth were showing and my tongue was out, and apparently I tried to walk across fire. We got dropped off at home by one of our friends, Kyle Hayden. The lights were on, and we knew we had been got. Bryce looks at me dead in the face as I'm laying on the siding of the house and said, "Get your shit together." I said, "I got this shit." I didn't. I cleaned the wall going down the hallway. Bryce just shook his head, and we got our ass chewed the next day. But what I'm staying by this story, and what we can all see, is Bryce had me. He has, in some shape, some form, had all of us. You called him for anything, he'd get it taken care of. And this right now, the amount of support and love from everyone for everyone, not just my family or our family. Since this whole nightmare began, this is Bryce's positivity that he wanted. It means that he will always have us. He'll always be with us. Bryce died being a hero. We're going to give him everything he deserves and everything that he wanted. There are no other words that we have to make this go away. And I wish this was all a nightmare. And I'd wake up in Baden, him on station 2, the night that we were both riding the officer seat of a fire truck, career. I'd call him when I left work, and he'd come over, and we'd have a couple beers. He'd tell Cheyenne it's time to leave. But rest easy, Bryce. We have it from here. And as the great Lieutenant Stephen McCaffrey said, that's my brother, goddammit.
Bryce was born on October 4th. For those that don't know, October 4th happens to be the feast day of St. Francis of Assisi, the patron saint of animals. And we all know about the Trossbach's involvement in the fire service, but in the 50 years that I've known the Trossbach, something else that I know that's really big with them is their involvement in the county fairs and showing animals and things. So with Bryce being born on the feast day of St. Francis of Assisi, I thought it would be appropriate to end this service with the prayer of St. Francis of Assisi. And as I read it, try to interject where Bryce's life fits into this poem. I think you will find it striking how similar it is. Lord, make me an instrument of thy peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. And where there is sadness, joy. O divine master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying to self that we are born to eternal life. When you leave here in a short while, I hope that, like me, you will leave with a feeling of having shared in something special for a very special man, Bryce Clayton Harper. And let us remind ourselves of that the dead reside not in the grave or an urn, but in the hearts and the minds of the living. Hold on to Bryce in your thoughts. There is no need to part from him too hastily. Talk about him often. Repeat the words and sayings that he used and the jokes that he made, and enjoy your memories of him just as we have here today. And all these things I humbly pray in Christ's holy name. Amen. At this time, the sea of blue is dismissed. And thank you for attending the service.